Thank you everyone for coming today. This is the panel discussion for Jumping Eagle versus Trump. As you all know, we are suing the United States government, in particular President Trump himself, as well as the Army, U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, and Energy Transfer Partners over Standing Rock. We hope and intend to actually stop this pipeline, at the very least to stop the oil from flowing through under Lake Oahe. That's our goal here in the court system. It's our goal to educate the world about this today. We're one of the last three cases standing in between Standing Rock and this pipeline, which is a reckless and dangerous and shocking one. So welcome and thank you for being here. Thank you around the world for watching us today. And thank you to our live streamers and all of the people who came today to help set up here. You've been fabulous. So I'd like to actually start with Dr. Sarah Jumping Eagle, who is, as you know, our lead plaintiff in the case, and ask you what it means for you to be a plaintiff in Jumping Eagle versus Trump, and whatever you'd like to say about that.
I'm glad to ask you. I guess I'll tell you my champion, because you have a lot here. My name is Dr. Sarah Jumping Eagle. I'm Oglala Lakota and Mittawaka Twin Dakota. I'm originally from Kyle, South Dakota, on the Pine Ridge Reservation, and I currently live on Standing Rock Reservation in North Dakota. And I'm a physician, I'm a pediatrician as well, and I've been active in public health and environmental health issues for going on 10 years now, I would say. What it means to me to be a part of this case and to be a plaintiff means that for us as Lakota people, we are going to continue to demand justice in this world, and we're going to hold those accountable who violate laws and who violate our rights. Not only our religious freedom rights, our right to clean water, but our right to live on the land and for our children to live on the land in the future as our relatives before us did. And those are the rights and our ways of life that we're going to continue to fight for.
I'll speak to you if that would be great.
Everybody, Hoshdewi Young, Achiapi, Ia Waslai Mataha. My name is Hoshdewi Young, and I'm from Standing Rock in North and South Dakota. I was born in North Dakota and I grew up on Standing Rock, and for the past 6 months we've been camped at the confluence of the Cannonball River and Missouri River, and so my family was out there. Previous to that, I worked as the Tribal Historic Preservation Officer for the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe from 2003 to 2015. In that capacity, I testified before the South Dakota Public Utilities Commission 3 years ago against the Dakota Access Pipeline, and on the basis that they did not consult, the Army Corps of Engineers did not consult with the tribe, and basically they had construction up and running in various states before any permits were issued. And that was 3 years ago. So after that job, I felt like I was able to freely voice my concerns as a mother and as a citizen of Standing Rock, and be able to stand up. And that's what we've been doing. And I'm so glad for this experience, and I'm glad to be able to be part of this case because of the environmental injustice that is occurring, the desecration of our sacred sites and our graves and our homelands, and ultimately, when it does leak, that will affect our primary drinking, our water source for Standing Rock. So that's why I'm happy to be here today. Thank you.
Turn the mic up, possibly people can't hear.
Okay. Yeah.
Up a little bit. Up.
I think you hold it right next to your mouth, it gets better coverage. Oh.
Okay.
Can you hear me better?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well, my name is Holly Al-Fafri. I am a Lakota woman of the Minikoju and Oglala Lakota bands. I am here today as a representative of our nations, of our Lakota people, but of all the indigenous people of the world who are whose lands are suffering the environmental injustices that we are facing. I have lived at the Ocheti Shakomi, Ocheti Oyate camp. It's been referred to as both. But I have lived there with my family, with my mother, with our children. And so we've seen a lot of things. We've witnessed a lot of hardship, a lot of things that most people in my world question. They say, how is that legal? How are they doing that? And I don't have the answer, because a lot of the things that we've experienced are not legal. And they're not okay. So I don't have the answer for the world when they say, that's not possible, because we've lived it, we've seen it, and it will continue to go on unless we stand up and we put our foot down and we say no more. We want to hold this country accountable. We want to set a precedent so that everyone in the world can hold their governments accountable for the destruction of our lands. So I am very, very honored to be here today. Thank you for coming.
My name is Dr. Shawnee Phillips. It's my Dakota name. I'm also of the Minikoju band. My daughters and I are enrolled members of the Shan River Sioux Tribe. And I'm here in part of this also in my work at home. I'm a clinical psychologist, but I'm here to see that we bring justice to our people. This environmental racism that's happened that is literally a legal violation of our laws in terms of the environmental impact statement being already in the Federal Register and not being honored by this administration, as well as our treaty rights being violated, our treaty rights to protect our water. And as we know, when DAPL leaks, we know that toxic tar sand oil will poison our waters, which touches everything and who we are. So literally this will result for us in genocide of sorts, and spiritually, culturally, the land, the water, the people. And so I know in my heart, every day when I look into my daughter's eyes, I need to be able to tell them that we've done whatever we can do on all the levels, on all the levels. It's a survival mode now to whatever we need to do to stand for this change, to stand for the truth of what really needs to be this paradigm shift. So when I look into their eyes, I need to be able to say we've done everything we can do to protect our culture, our people, our water.
Thank you. Thank you all. I don't know. And you may have noticed that this is sort of a women-led lawsuit. We do have men as plaintiffs as well, but the majority are women. And that seems to be very fitting for these times. So before we go further into the rest of the issues we're facing, how about we have Bruce Afron talk about our case, how our case differs from the other cases that are out there to stop this pipeline, and what he thinks about our chances for it.
Thank you, Tangerine. I'm glad you're all here. Thank you for being here. As Tangerine said, I'm acting as the lead attorney. Actually, Red Wolf is an attorney, as you know, and has participated in drafting the complaint. We have several other lawyers. Oliver Hall from Washington is not here, and he's acting as our local counsel. And Carl Mayer and Zach Lischka are also going to play a role as well. Actually, Zach and Red Wolf went to law school for 1 year in Seattle together. Is that right? Yes. We're now the third group to join this case. The Standing Rock Tribe filed the initial lawsuit, the Cheyenne River Sioux Tribe then joined. It's moved to intervene. And now we, representing number one, our four plaintiffs here, and others are representing individual tribal members, as opposed to the tribal governments. Now, there are a lot of reasons for that. In part, the tribal government's arguments were somewhat limited. We think we have other arguments to add into this case that have not been raised. Also, governments of any kind have interests that sometimes differ from individuals. So we think it's important that the individuals who will drink this water, who practice their faith at this location, and whose ancestral and to a great degree treaty lands have been affected, should be here in this case. So we've moved to intervene. We have 14 plaintiffs led by Dr. Sarah Jumping Eagle, and to a degree we've exploited Sarah's name because Jumping Eagle v. Trump just has a good cachet to it. Someone created a meme, I don't know if it was done for this case, but there's a meme out there of an eagle at a desk pecking away at Trump's hand and he jumps away in shock. Those are real photos, obviously joined together, but Trump is jumping away for some reason in the picture, so someone added the eagle. So we now have a jumping eagle on Trump, and so we've exploited Sarah's name to a degree. But Sarah actually has been very, very active in all of these issues, really, and it's not really exploitation. She deserves to be in a lead position. What we've argued is twofold. One, we've taken up the religious issues that tribes have raised. The use of the water is from Lake Oahe and the Missouri River complex are fundamental to the Lakota faith. And one issue that was raised recently before the judge here, Judge Boasberg, was whether or not this is the only place one can get this water for the religious practice. I'm not sure the tribes handled that argument very well, to be honest. The affidavits we have say this water is sacred to our faith. The tribes weren't so clear about that, and that's really why individuals can be more valuable sometimes than a government. It's also not clear that a tribal government can even come to court and endorse the religious practice of its citizens. The First Amendment doesn't really allow that. And the statute, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, doesn't allow it. So it's good to have individuals here who would have standing in any case. We're also arguing that the Army, under President Trump, illegally reversed the Army's position from 6 weeks earlier under President Obama. Now, what happened last summer was that permits were given by the Army Corps to Dakota Access to build a pipeline in general, but they hadn't yet rendered a decision on the easement to cross under what the Army calls its lands at Lake Oahe. Now, the waters are controlled in large part by the tribal governments who have reserved rights. But these were really treaty lands that were diminished by Congress at various times in the 20th century. So although the Army Corps has title to it, the tribes ultimately claim ownership of this. But in terms of the narrower issues we're faced with right now, in December, the Army Corps issued a whole set of fairly comprehensive findings that not enough study had been given to one, alternative routes. No study was given to it by anybody except Dakota Access. The Army rubber stamped its report. And two, the environmental impacts of a leak at this location. And three, the impact on cultural and religious life for the tribal members and their governments at that location. And the Army Corps issued extensive findings explaining why more study was needed. Well, President Trump came into office and simply ordered by what he called a presidential memorandum, which is not something I knew existed. He said, I instruct the Secretary of the Army to instruct the Army Corps of Engineers to expedite its review and to end the comment and notice periods. Now, the Army had set February 20th as a date for the public, tribal members, governments, anyone to comment on the easement. And President Trump simply ordered the comment period closed on February 7th. And then ordered, January 23rd when he did this, and ordered the Army Corps to expedite its review. Now, where does a president, no matter who he is, get the power to order an expert agency to expedite its review. Well, he doesn't have that power. You know, imagine a group of engineers are assigned by Congress the task of approving a permit based upon environmental study. And the president, who's a real estate broker, he comes in and he announces, well, I'm ordering you to expedite that review. You know, I who build hotels and things of that nature, I can tell you that you don't need more time. I can order you to hurry up your expert analysis. That's precisely what happened. And the Army, being the Army, just followed President Trump's diktat, so to speak. So the issue we're really challenging here administratively is that the president had no power to do what he did. That's one thing. That's why Jumping Eagle is suing Trump, because President Trump does not have that authority. Now, the president has a lot of powers, but this is not one of them. And the case law says where there appears to be political coercion on an expert agency, the court has to look very carefully at the result of that inquiry. The second point is that even assuming he had the power to expedite that review, which he didn't, the Army Corps simply announced, we've concluded our review, we find the original record from before December was fine, and we accept the easement, we don't see any need for further study. Now, although they took about 8 pages to say that, literally most of the 8 pages was just a listing of all the documents that were earlier in the record. They literally made no findings of fact as to why they now disagreed with themselves from 6 weeks earlier. 6 weeks earlier, they said, we need more study. They explained why. President Trump comes in, and all of a sudden, well, we don't need any study. The original record was fine, and we don't have to tell you why we think that now. And that's really where we stand. We actually are in that sort of, you know, Alice in Wonderland world, where, you know, black is black on December 20th, and black now becomes white on January 23rd. And the sky is up one day, and it's down the next day, and two is three, and three is two. We're simply switching around things. And so this is actually a very strong case, in my view, because administrative agencies have to make findings. They're courts, actually. They have to study a case, they hear evidence. They can't cut off the comment period 2 weeks earlier and prevent our clients here from introducing their comments. And they can't simply rubber stamp a decision without explaining in detail and in substance why they're doing it. Well, that's exactly what has happened here. So that is essentially what this case is about. I just want to take one brief comment on one point. You know, we hear often about how Congress has plenary power over the affairs of Indian nations, Native American nations. And you know where that comes from? It's interesting, because sometimes we have these doctrines of law that are repeated over and over again over like 100 years, and everyone just believes them. And no one bothers after a while to look at, well, what was the original principle that led to that conclusion? And I decided to do that, and this notion that Congress has this plenary power over Indian nations comes from two places. And the Supreme Court has said, well, it comes from the Indian Commerce Clause, in which the Constitution says Congress shall regulate commerce between the states and between the Indian nations and the states. All right, well, the power to regulate commerce doesn't seem to me to come with the power to take half the land of a dependent nation. It doesn't come with the power to take half of New Jersey. And it doesn't seem to me that merely regulating commerce gives rise to the right to steal land, so that other people can engage in commerce. Now, yes, it's true, it's commerce is readable for saying to mine gold on someone else's land. You're in commerce. But does the power to regulate commerce give you the right to steal land from someone so someone else can trade? That principle is wrong. The other place where the court says Congress can disregard treaties with Native American nations is in the treaty clause of the Constitution, where it says Congress can make treaties. And therefore, the reasoning is, well, if Congress can make treaties, Congress can disregard them. Now, have you ever noticed Vancouver Island? It dips down below the 49th parallel. The rest of the U.S. is on the 49th parallel. And Vancouver Island, which is Canada, kind of dips down about 3 degrees. Go look on the map above Washington State one day. Well, we had a treaty with Britain that defined the boundaries of the 49th parallel between Canada and the US, except for Vancouver Island. They wanted all of it, so it dips down below the 49th parallel. Does Congress have the power legally to say, well, we decided the Canadians really aren't using enough of Vancouver Island, and we're going to take the bottom part of it that sticks down below the 49th parallel so we can have a nice even boundary and we can get some of that land which the Canadians just don't know how to use. Now, obviously, Congress can't do that. And it seems to me the idea that it can do it to Indian nations is equally fallacious. So that's a good summary of where we are in this case. Thank you all. Well, you're not the moderator, so you hadn't thought it out.
No.
Well, let's talk about where the case will go, and then maybe our plaintiffs want to weigh in, too.
Okay.
So, let me just lay out where we are in this lawsuit, then. Red Wolf, did you want to jump in with anything?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay. Well, you want to go now? And then I'll follow? Okay. Red Wolf. Is that the case?
So, one of the aspects that has been important from the start is the sacred aspect of the land. As was mentioned, the sacred aspect, it's hard to bring that into alignment with the way things are done in the government. And cases like this illustrate that point very well. The difference between the cultures and what they see as valuable. Recently, I don't know who had the chance to attend there was a prayer service at the National Cathedral, and there was a point made there that was very poignant. And it asked everyone there to imagine what they would do if it was determined that it would be expedient to run an oil pipeline right through that cathedral. And until people have that sort of personal understanding, a metaphor that makes sense in what is sacred to them, what their experience is to them, they don't fully always understand the scope of what's happening out there. We're trying to do that for the courts, and we're trying to do that in a way that meets both their understanding of what sacredness is to the people of the land where this is happening, but also is couched in an argument that they can take action on. Something that is backed up by law, which unfortunately tribes right now, until they are not domestic dependent nations, are working within courts of law that were designed by another culture. And that's always the struggle here, is to take one culture's understanding of a worldview and to make an argument that another culture will understand and take action on. So we're working on, in this case, really making sure that the sacredness is taken into account. I was out there and I asked why the place was called Cannonball when I first came. And I don't know that this was ever spoken of enough in any of the articles I read or any of the media, but the reason it's called Cannonball is because of the natural whirlpools that used to form perfectly round stones. Huh. And I apologize because my pronunciation of the language of the Lakota Yate is not always perfect, but Twin Khan is what I was told, that these round stones are very sacred, and that they can represent many things, and they're used as a focal point in ceremony. And I was told they represent that oneness, that wholeness, the earth, the entire universe, and the center of the universe, which is also within each of us. And so that stone is a microcosm of everything sacred. And that's the place they form, right there, at Cannonball, at Standing. Crazy Horse himself wore a Tung Khan when he would ride into battle, and he was never wounded in battle. And so These stones, they are sacred in and of themselves, but the place that they form is sacred. The water that forms them is sacred. And whereas all water is sacred, all water is life, that place is very special. That place is very significant. And it's already been desecrated other times. First, when there was the wars that where that land even had to be put under treaty control. Second, when Lake Oahe was formed. And that as well, they were going to put the dam further north. And they decided, oh, that would affect too many non-native ranchers. And so instead they put it on the reservation. And a lot of land was lost. A lot of people were forced out of their homes. And now we see it again, where they say, oh, that's a very convenient place to reroute. And these aspects are being argued in this case. We're trying to bring up not just the sacredness of water, but the sacredness of this specific body of water, the sacredness of this specific place, all the burial sites that have been desecrated, all of the sacred sites and the prayer sites that are around this, and people, they don't maybe have the experience of always relating to a natural place as sacred, and that's one problem we do have with the government. They always look for structures. They always look for proof. Show us something you built here. Show us how you changed the natural landscape so that we can understand that you thought it was sacred in its natural form. And that's a very difficult thing to do. And so working in Indian law it itself is many times a contradiction in worlds. And so as we move forward, we're going to be working very closely, you know, with the people, the plaintiffs, the tribe, the historians, to help make sure that we're not leaving anything out. And this case, as we move forward, we want to really honor the experience of the people. We want to really honor the sacredness of those places and bring in things such as NAGPRA, religious freedom, that are very powerful, that this larger society does understand the importance of, and bring in things that maybe they've never even held as sacred or as religion, and help them understand that that is what we're protecting there. That is what this case is about. It's not just about land rights. It's not just about human rights. It's not just about the honoring of treaties. It's everything. This case is very unique in that there is not an area of law that it doesn't touch in some way. And so then the challenge is to take all those pieces and make them a cohesive whole that is understandable in a short fashion to a court on a few sheets of paper.
Point, I did want to make that point. The complaint actually also alleges environmental discrimination. This is an area of law that's not widely litigated. While we're a government agency, grants a permit to any private developer to engage in any kind of potentially threatening activity, if an environmental threat. If it falls unduly the burden on an ethnic or racial minority, and there's no logical explanation for why that location was chosen, one argues that that violates the civil rights laws of the United States. And so here there was initial consideration given to running this pipeline near Bismarck, a mostly white community. And then it was pulled from there with no real analysis, except to say, well, there are a lot of streams over there that have to go through. And it was put over here, right where the Sioux communities are based, almost exclusively Sioux in ethnicity and nationality. And any leak is going to burden those communities and their drinking water. And no explanation has been given as to why, in substance, the original route by Bismarck or alternate routes could not have been used. So that's another element of our complaint. And the Obama administration said not enough study was given to this. No study was given to this. Then the Army Corps turns around under Trump 6 weeks later and says enough study was given, but doesn't explain why it now disagrees. So that's the essence of the case. Let me just take one moment, and maybe our plaintiffs should be heard on all these issues, you know, the impact of the water and such on their lives. I just want to say where we are in the case. The two tribes lost their motion on religious grounds earlier in the week. Judge Boasberg found, in essence, that they haven't shown that their religious practice will be destroyed by the threat to the water or the intrusion into the water area. I think he's wrong, because the law says only that there must be a substantial burden, not a destruction of the religious right. And so I think he's wrong, and probably that can be overturned on appeal. But for the time being, the religious freedom issue seems to have been addressed by the court. It can go further, there can be a trial, but at this point, the judge seems to have addressed that. The next step will be, there's a summary judgment motion pending by the tribes on the administrative law issues, and we will join in with our own brief on those points, addressing basically what I outlined before. Probably by the middle of May, the legal issues will be resolved one way or the other. Now, it's possible there might be a trial ultimately on the environmental questions. So even if this oil begins to flow, the case is not over. The oil can flow, we don't want it to, it could start. Judge Boasberg in May, June, July, August can rule in our favor and stop that flow of oil. So don't ever be discouraged because you hear, well, that motion lost, they're gonna start the oil. I'll just tell you one little story. In Princeton, I've been representing a group of people in New Jersey to stop construction of 15 houses on a part of the Princeton battlefield. That was from the Revolutionary War. And this group said, no, there should be no construction on this land, even though it's privately owned, because the law bars construction that destroys a historic site in New Jersey. Well, this is the Institute for Advanced Study, Einstein's school in Princeton, a fairly wealthy, quite a wealthy institution, that wants to build. And my group was a public interest group that stood up. They raised money. They raised about $250,000 to hire experts over a period of 6 or 7 years. Well, these plans were filed in 2010. We've been litigating ever since, and not one house has yet been built.
Ooh.
And they've now given in and they've agreed to give back 3/4 of the field to the public in exchange for some money, but nevertheless. So when we first started this case, we were told, oh, the fix is in, the courts will never pay attention to you because the Institute's a powerful institution. And I said, that's nonsense. We litigate because we have the right to litigate. So 6 years later, 7 years later, not one house is built on that site. So don't be discouraged, and we've lost things in that case, and we've won things. Don't be discouraged when you hear about a loss. Judge Boasberg is only one judge, and we don't know how he'll handle the other issues. Then there's an appeals court above them, and there the Supreme Court above them. And in law, you gotta be in it to the end to know the result. So don't say, oh, we lost, we can't support it anymore, I'm not gonna give any money. That's how you lose cases. You gotta stay in it. And because a single loss now doesn't mean anything. And by the way, that's the whole history of Indian law in this country. For a long time, Native American groups were abused in law. And then the worm turned. And in the early part of the 20th century, courts started to recognize these rights. And even though there are setbacks today, there's a huge body of law that favors Native American nations. And that's what we use. So don't ever be discouraged when you hear about a temporary setback.
Thank you. Excellent. Excuse me.
I think it'd be useful to share another piece that probably both, most of you here are aware of, but people ask me, so why, if this pipe is gonna be buried so deep in the land, how does it affect, you know, the water, and how does it affect your spirituality? And in our Lakota prophecies, there's a prophecy of the black snake, and just the existence of the pipe under the earth, oil or not, the existence of it is a violation of our spiritual ways, because it is literally a rape, a violation of Mother Earth. And they ask, so if it is 100 feet deep, how will it pollute the water? And one thing is that I think this pipe has 187 places where it's welded. And if you can imagine threading anything into the earth that has that many welded spots, and it has to go down and it has to go around several angles, the likelihood that there will be no leaks before oil even flows, it is impossible. And once the oil flows, this toxic tar sand oil, most poisonous kind of oil, will leak down into the earth, and they have no technology to detect those leaks, and they have certainly no way to repair them. If you can imagine this being 100 feet deep. Not only that, but there are aquifers straight down, and when that oil leaks into the earth, it would poison those aquifers that affect many other states. So once this oil leaks from the pipelines, we know it goes into the earth, we know it goes into the water, affecting the medicinal plants in the water, affecting the animals that drink the water, affecting our cultural ways of fishing and hunting that are central in our spiritual ways, our cultural ways. It affects everything from there. Our ceremony, so much of our ceremony and spiritual ways involve water. And in taking water, the abstinence from water, honoring water as a source of life, not just a resource, a source of life. And so when this oil flows, it's affecting all the levels, biologically, culturally, spiritually, in all the ways. There's no way. We know by the other oil spills already how it will affect health. And the oil spills, for example, in Enbridge, we see the dramatic rise in cancer, in terminal illnesses, in deaths, dramatic, of the animals, of the people. And so we are doing everything we can do to take a stand for protecting our spiritual ways, but also literally protecting a physical genocide of our people. The relocation that has happened on our reservation some years back to infertile lands already has been such a violation of our people, and to have the waters flow, it's our only source of water for the Great Sioux Nation. So if you think about your only source of water is poison, how could that not affect everything?
Sorry, I'm late. Apparently there's a marathon and I was not aware. I'm sure I missed most of it, but I kind of wanted to get, for the plaintiffs, I wanted to get to the plaintiffs. We know, obviously, why we're going after specifically the president and the Army Corps and the oil company itself, but I wanted to talk about the treaty aspect, because it seems like a very, something that judges don't particularly want to touch, but if we follow the laws in America, is the supreme law of the land. What do you think in terms of the treaty violations? Because according to federal Indian lawyers I've spoken to, this whole pipeline route is actually on Standing Rock Sioux land, not just how they navigate, oh, well, this is where the Standing Rock Sioux Reservation is not going to be affected. Can you kind of talk about the treaty right violations open to any of the plaintiffs?
Well, we know that the area that the Dakota Access Pipeline was being constructed and the area where the Ochetioyate camps are all treaty territory. 1851 and the 1868 treaties guaranteed our Lakota people's rights to those lands. And it was not only the land, but the use of the waters, hunting, fishing rights, and our right to live there. But during the times gradually that the US government decided that it wanted more and more land, it's been gradually chipped away, but there was never a new treaty put in place. And so those laws still stand. The other aspect of the treaty rights to the area is that we never gave up use of those lands. The Cannonball Ranch is actually another area that is should be a historic under the Historic Preservation Act as well. We have stories in that area of our people fleeing the cavalry. We have places there that are sacred and that are often used. So for the government, and especially the state of North Dakota, to allow the energy transfer partners and Dakota Access Company to purchase that land without our agreement to that, not only to purchase it, but then to use it to contaminate our water, is so egregious. And of course, the government is trying to avoid addressing those issues as far as, because they know that that we're right. And so they want to continue to justify their use of eminent domain, and we've seen that in other areas too. People are fighting in Iowa and Nebraska against the pipeline as well. So they are going to continue to try to avoid those issues because they have no standing. The treaties were negotiated as part of, and I think in America they like to forget our history, but the Lakota people won a war, and the United States government had to come and negotiate peace with our people, and that was how those treaty boundaries were defined. And so although the U.S. government and people want to forget that those were the negotiations that happened, we don't forget, and we know that is our land that we live on.
I would like to thank Bruce for mentioning that just because there's a loss, to not lose hope, because there are many, many ways that we can go about this. And to speak on the treaty aspect, the land that the Ochenti Shakoi camp was on treaty land, the land that the, all of that land there. So we stood on that land. We lived there. And we were protecting the water. We were protecting the land because that is our land. We, like Sarah says, we don't forget. We have never forgotten that those are our lands. They belong to us. They belong to our ancestors. They belong to all the generations coming. That we have relatives that bathe their children in that water, that drink that water, that depend solely on that water source. And so we stood there and we lived there and we prayed there in defense of all of that. I believe that we should have been allowed legally to remain, because those are our treaty lands, and that is our right to stand on treaty lands, especially in defense of everything that is sacred to us. We were involved in, at the end, we were issued the eviction. A really unfair and unrealistic eviction, given the timeline that we had. We had been making attempts to clean, to protect and take care of the land, and it just was impossible to finish that job in the timeline that they had wanted us to. I had been told at different times from different strategists that being there in that location was not, that there was nothing we could do. It was not a good strategy. But we didn't feel that way, because in our hearts we knew that was where we were supposed to be, because those are our treaty lines, and it's right there. It's right there in the face of DAPL. It's right there in the face of the construction of that pipeline. And we have the right to be there as descendants of the treaties. Now, how, after everything played out, we saw the aggression, we felt, we lived through the aggression, we lived through all of the different, the violations of laws on every level. I'm sorry, it's still blurry. We lived through that, and we went through the eviction as that process happened every day. You know, in the beginning of that negotiation process, we asked the Army Corps of Engineers for an extension on that date. That every day they came back and said no. The whole world called the Army Corps of Engineers and asked for an extension. Every day they came back in the morning for that meeting and they said no. So finally, in those last 2 days, they wanted to come in and they wanted to continue the cleaning, and we said no. You cannot. You know, you have not given us any honor in this process, so you cannot come in today. We need to have this time to pray together, to be together, to honor all of our sacred things that we don't have time to get out of here. There were sacred things within the camp that were disrespected in their bulldozing after the eviction, during the eviction. So we believe that was our place to stand, to be. We were pleading, we were wanting to move to higher ground because nobody wants to be in a flood. And we, you know, there was all this talk of a flood, but they never brought any science, any facts, any papers stating, you know, any history of weather reports, any predictions of that there might actually be a flood. There was just talk. And, you know, but even considering that, we were still cleaning up and we wanted to move to higher ground. We wanted to hold our ground because that's what we believed and we felt in our hearts. That is, you know, that's our treaty land. So everything happened and then we were removed. After the fact of being removed, it was acknowledged to me that yes, this was the most powerful place you guys could have been. There are many pipelines that are near Indian lands, that are near sacred sites, but that none are as close to treaty lands as the Dakota Access Pipeline. And they referenced in past tense that we had the strongest point in that land we were at. And so it's been really hard to bear that knowledge that we knew that. That's what we were telling the world. That's why we stayed. And then to have it acknowledged after the fact, as in past tense, like we no longer have that. It's not true. That it's not a past tense thing. It's still our land. We still have this stance, and you know, maybe we have to come in through a different door now. You know, through the laws of the courts. But we're not a people that give up. Even if there's a loss, as Bruce said, you know, don't lose hope. The power is within all of us collectively. It's within all of us individually to stand up and to, you know, to keep going until we find the right door that's gonna get us
to where we need to be. So throughout, you know, we're resilient and we need to continue to hold our hope and to hold our prayer and our belief and keep moving forward. So, that's what I
would
say. Thank you.
And I'll just add to that, as somebody who was there many times, I found it just comical that the Army Corps, the governor, all the folks of North Dakota and the federal government, they weren't concerned about anybody's safety for months, getting brutalized. Suddenly, when they wanted you out for their own reasons, it could flood, and debris might go into the water. So it was obviously, not genuine. Bruce, I wanted to ask you two things. One, for the layman who hasn't been attached to this case, isn't it illegal in the first place that they didn't do an environmental impact study? I know that the company kind of fudged it a little bit, making it seem like it wasn't one long pipeline. They made it seem like it was several smaller things connecting. But couldn't that be used, the fact that for an infrastructure project this large, there was not an environmental impact study done? And the second part to that is, how is this case different than the other ones as far as what was illegal in terms of the environmental impact study process.
Sure. When you say this case, what do you mean by that? Our particular case. Well, the issues are the same. In the tribe's case and our individual plaintiff's case are really the same. We think we have arguments that may be more sophisticated than their lawyers have used in certain areas. And so there is a difference. We will argue things a little differently, certainly. But I think the issues are all common to all the cases. We're the only ones who sued President Trump. And we're the only ones who've made an issue out of the fact that he didn't have the power to do what he did. To order, before you got here, I mentioned that the president does not have the power to order an expert agency to expedite or hurry up its review. Presidents just can't do that. And we've also asked for damages only because we thought that's a way of getting his particular attention, since money is important to the president. He did own shares, and I think he may still own shares, in Energy Transfer Partners. And so that makes it more egregious that he interfered in this process by an order to hurry up the inquiry and to end the comment period. I mean, the president is exceeding his authority, and he does so in favor of a business in which he owns shares. That's fairly egregious personal intervention. And that's why we sue the president personally. And I don't know where that will go, but that's a different issue than the tribes have raised. So that we've added that dimension into the case. You know, the reason no environmental impact statement was done was because the Dakota Access Partners got away with arguing that this was, as you just mentioned, a series of little segments of pipelines that each would stand or could stand independently. Now, this thing's gonna run from North Dakota way down to, I guess, St. Louis, I forget exactly where it ends. You know, it's 1,700 miles. And obviously, no one is building this just to bring oil from, say, Cannonball to, name a town in North South Dakota. Sioux Falls. No one's making this pipeline just to truck oil from Cannonball to Sioux Falls and say, well, we built a separate pipeline from Cannonball to Sioux Falls. But that's exactly what the Dakota Access got away with. They convinced the Army that, well, because each section could be a beginning and an end of a separate pipeline, we don't really need to do an environmental impact statement because no one segment is long enough to justify it under the law. So by this fiction that they're not building one long pipeline, but they're building little pipelines that by coincidence will all communicate with each other, they got away without the required environmental impact statement. And this is one of the things that the Army Corps looked at and said in December, you know, we need more study as to whether it's appropriate to have avoided that test. You know, this is one of those reasons people go to law school at times, so they come up with rationalizations to help their client. And, you know, the Dakota Access lawyers deserve credit for coming up with this deceptive scheme and in manipulating the environmental laws of the United States. But it is a manipulation. I mean, it makes no more sense than to say a worm is 20 separate segments and that, you know, each one can crawl around on its own.
Or a snake.
Right, I mean, you don't chop a snake in 20 pieces and say, look at the 20 pieces. It's one cohesive unit. It's intended to bring oil from the north to the south. And obviously this was a deception. So that's how they got away with it. And the Trump administration has offered no explanation. And you can look at the papers yourselves as to why they now changed their view from 6 weeks earlier. And you know, what lawyers do is they'll write up a finding, a piece of paper, right, 8-9 pages, that looks like it says a lot. And in reality, it says very little. And mostly it's just a listing of every document that was filed a year earlier. And then at the end they say, we've reviewed this and find that the record was good enough, but they don't explain why. And literally, you go through 8 pages of densely written material to find no explanation of what the Army Corps did as to why they did it on February 3rd and February 7th of this month, of this past month. The other point I'll raise is that, I'm sorry, I lost the other point, but that's good.
We haven't talked a lot about the environmental risk here, and obviously there are people with whom we're dealing who know a lot more about this and will speak to it in court. But we do have experts from around the world, mechanical engineers, water specialists, et cetera, who, people who build these pipelines for a living. And they have parsed them, analyzed this pipeline quite thoroughly. I don't know if all of you know this already, but the length of pipeline that is being routed under Lake Oahu is 7,500 feet long. It's called horizontal directional drilling, HDD pipeline. This is by far the longest length of pipeline ever recorded on record. The next closest is 3,000 feet. So this has never been done before. The Army Corps and Energy Transfer Partners, et cetera, are all claiming that this is a safe route. That's an absolutely ludicrous and unsupportable claim. There are so many problems with this process. Not only is this an unprecedented length of pipeline, there's no way to inspect the oil as it's flowing through. So a long, slow, continuous leak is what will happen. Our experts have made it quite clear this is not an if scenario, this is a when. This is a when this will leak. There are three aquifers under Lake Oahu. This water source connects to downstream. There are 17 to 20 million people who will be affected. So this is basically a catastrophe waiting to happen. It's a long, slow developing catastrophe, but that's the scenario we can realistically predict and that we can really show in court. So not only that, but just one quick last detail on this pipeline, because it's been such a bizarre process. The weld joints of an HDD length of pipeline are every 40 to 80 feet. Those weld joints, by nature, are susceptible. They're vulnerable points for this pipeline. The federal government, which is basically a captured party by this industry, only requires that 10% of those weld joints are inspected before this HDD length of pipeline goes underground. When it goes underground, it's pulled under Lake Oahu from one side to the other, and it's not inspected afterward. There's no technology in existence that is capable of inspecting this pipeline once oil starts flowing.
Yeah, I'll just add, any lawsuit requires money, to be honest. You know, the Citizens United case said money is speech, and speech is money. Well, money is law, and law is money, because it takes time and effort. There are expenses in a case, aside from lawyers getting paid something reasonably. There are also experts who need to be hired. There's printing, there's travel, so we really need that financial support. Not that you should do it, but just looking at numbers, if there are 50 or 60 people in this room right now, and $100 comes from each person on average, right there you have $6,000. If 1,000 people around the world listen to this and put in $100, we've got a budget that will more than carry this case. So collectively, people can put together small amounts to equal a war chest that can effectively counter a large corporate entity. I do that all the time. And so don't think it can't be done. It really is very practical, and we need to do that. Sir?
Yeah, I went to two of the hearings on the 7th and 27th and listened to what Boasberg said. And it seemed to me he was pandering in a condescending way to the idea of the black snake, that spiritual issues weren't really relevant in his courtroom. But what he did say, which is important, was that the oil flowing in the pipe posed imminent and immediate threat. And that's why he denied the temporary restraining order at that time, saying that at a future time we will reconsider this. Seems like on the 27th and the most recent one, it was never really brought up again. And that's where it seems to me, and maybe you can point us up on this, that the EIS is crucial in this place to fill out the necessity to see if there are going to be immediate and imminent risks when the state, which is the term you use, is turned on.
Yeah, I mean, the idea of the black snake prophecy, of course, is a real religious prophecy. But I think the tribe's argument was a little bit synthetic in saying the oil flowing brings up the black snake prophecy. I think the better argument is individuals who practice their religious faith and use the waters and find those waters to be unsuited now have their faith interfered with. I think that's the stronger argument, and if we do it again, that's the argument we're going to focus on. With regard to what Judge Boasberg said, he said, look, the harm does not arise until the oil flows. That's why he first denied the motion. We need to focus on that environmental risk. There is absolute environmental risk. These pipelines burst open and break with some degree of frequency. And they pollute water. You can fix that eventually, not always promptly. It could be months before water supplies are restored. The very existence of the pipeline at the place of a water supply does pose a risk of irreparable harm. And that is what we have to get the case focused back on. And that is why we have to argue the administrative process thus far under the Trump administration's view of it has ignored this question.
Right. And that's what we have to refocus the case on.
The other question is, the reason he denied the TRO was because there was pressure applied by EPP to keep the drilling going. Keep the drilling going and put the pipe in there. And so I think the judge, feeling that pressure, I don't know within his mind, said that these guys, the pressure they're applying, they want to lay that pipe as quickly as possible.
Let me address that because we're going to run out of time. I don't think the judge
was responding to corporate pressure. You know, people in an activist community always think that. I don't think that's the case. What the judge was saying was that the harm does not arise unless oil flows.
Right.
So merely drilling the pipeline doesn't create what we call irreparable harm. And he was saying, look, if NETPL wins, they might as well at least have their trench in place. If they lose, there's a trench in place, that doesn't cause environmental harm in itself. He wasn't giving in to pressure from the corporation. He was creating a balance of the equities, which is his job. So I wouldn't say go that far. I would say he was doing the job judges have to do, and they have to balance interests at times. But I don't think the court is biased. I think courts are almost never biased. I have beaten large corporations in many cases, and judges are perfectly willing to hear those arguments. So I would say don't believe the system's rigged against us. It's not.
One last question, and I'd like it directed to one of the native plaintiffs. So if you have a question for the native plaintiffs, raise your hand. Going once, twice, sold.
It's a simple one. What would you ask of all of us in this room if each person could comment, just something that each of us could do to assist your efforts?
That has to be super quick, sorry.
I would ask you to share the information from the Revolution Truth about our case and the importance of our case. I would also ask people to look at ACLU North Dakota. There's been many human rights and civil rights violations, and we've been living in occupied territory for quite some time now. And also to contact your leadership in your state and ask them what they're doing about this.
I think that in the interest of time, that everything Sarah said was very, very good. So praying with us, placing the intention with us, continuing to support the feeds because that shares the information so that we can hopefully get it more into mainstream. And I think that's one of the things that we're grateful for with this particular group here that's representing this lawsuit is that in the courtroom, they're not necessarily gonna understand our worldview and way of life. And so there's a need to create this bridge to have it be in the language of the court so that that judge or whatever judge hears this case is going to be able to grab onto it in the way they can understand.
See the injustices, the environmental injustices and the spiritual injustices and the legal injustices that this situation has created. So we're grateful for you standing with us and we ask you to continue standing with us wherever you are in whatever way you can on social media, in your own home, in your own prayers.
And I'll end real quick. Separate from this case, I think everybody should keep in their mind individual cases like Red Fawn, who has, in my view, been railroaded through the system there in North Dakota, as well as, at this point, hundreds of water protectors who have had charges concocted out of thin air.
Including our plaintiffs, by the way.
Yes, including.
Many of whom face cases.
A lot of those cases, you can get information at TYT Politics or Unicorn Riot or at Higgins. A lot of independent media has covered those cases, so if you want to know more, just go back into their archives. Thank you for coming and watching.
Can we close with the prayer song? There's also the Water Protector Legal Collective and Freshet are also supporting the legal cases for individual water protectors.
Closing prayer.
Thank you all. I want to thank our plaintiffs, the women here leading the way. And I'm going to share a song from my mother's people, the Twinke. And this one is asking Creator for strength. It's called Going Up Above. In our language, there's two ways to say Creator, Hashi Yanya, or Gekan, Gakion Kawu. So you'll hear that in the song. I'm going to sing this one actually without the drum.
There's certain different ways we share it.
Hey, hey, aha. Thank you all.
Thank you.